Hello students, welcome to the next session of your C++ language. So in the previous module we have studied how our program works. So you have already studied that the code was divided into six major parts, and the first part was to write the hash include iostream.h, which was regarded as the header file. So header files plays a very important role in our C++ language. So let us now discuss about the header files. So header files are what? Header files are the definitions of functions and the variables which are used in any program. So they are used in any program, and they are always written by using a preprocessor, that is the hash include. You can see that we had written hash include in the less than greater than we had written iostream.h. So always hash include word preprocessor is included in our header file. So the header file always contains the .h extension also, and it will invoke our function declaration. Means our function will work more efficiently with the extension .h. But it has been seen that some softwares work with .h and some softwares don't work with .h. So it has to be checked whether our header file with .h extension is working or it is working without .h extensions. So that has to be, that care has to be taken while writing our programs in the C++ language. So note, or you have to note here, that without the header file, if we don't include the header files in our programs, then the compiler will show an error and it will say that include the header files, else the program will not work. So that is why the compiler can't use a particular function for the compilation of the task. It asks the user to insert the header files. So I have listed some of the header files. Here you can see in the red, these are the syntax of writing the header file, that is hash include iostream.h. So IO stands for input output. So I is for input, O is for output, and stream, you had already studied that the stream is the window where the bytes are written. So, or it is called the stream. So it will implement the input and the output. So whatever you are inputting the data, whatever you are asking from the compiler to print on the output, so if you are not including this iostream.h, the functions will not be executed. Second header file is our stdio.h. So std means standard input output functions. So in the library of the C++ language, there are some standard input output functions like get, puts and so on, get, care, etc. So there are many others. So you can see the library files also. So these are the standard input output functions files that has to be included, and you will have to write these header file, that is hash include stdio.h. Next type of the header file is the ctype.h. So ctype means C stands for the character. So when we have to insert any character type, then we use this header file. So when we are using any character, supposing we have a character x, variable x, and we want to see, we want to check whether the alpha is our, if supposing alpha is our character, then we want to check, is alpha greater than 0, is alpha less than 0, is a particular digit less than greater than 0, whatever is our program and whatever we want the digit to be done. So if it is digit, it is lower, is upper, it is going to upper. So these type of character functions will be executed only if we include the header file ctype.h. The next header file is the string.h. So in the string.h, again, we have certain string based functions. So we have to include our header file string.h, and we shall study in details about the strings when we move to the higher modules. Next header file is our math.h. So math.h means whatever mathematical operations we have to evaluate, what to calculate, supposing we have to calculate addition, subtraction, we have to calculate the power, square root, cube, root, sine, trigonometry functions, any of the mathematical operations have to be involved in our program, then we have to insert the header file of hash include math.h. And one more header file is the standard lib.h, that is the standard library.h header file. And as the name suggests, it is the library of the C++ language, and in this standard functions are inbuilt in this library. And if we call this randomize random, any of the call of the function is called, then it will automatically react to this name and it will perform the desired operation. So some functions are saved in the standard library. So like this, these are some of the examples of the header files. At the total, we have 47 header files in the C++ language, and we have to use these header files depending upon the type of operations, functions we are doing in our C++ program. Next, we study about the fundamental data types or the constants. So first is the constant. You know, what do you mean by constant? Constant is always a fixed value. So like you have a value of pi, which is 22/7, that is 3.14. So once you fix the value of the constant, that constant value is taken for the entire program and it will not be changed anywhere in the program. It is not that if you have assigned a equal to 2, then every time in the program, the value of a equal to 2 will be taken. It will never take a equal to 4 unless and until you change initially in your program. So the constants are always having a fixed value. They have to be initialized at the time of the program when you are creating it, and the new values cannot be assigned later on. So what is the syntax of writing the constant value? So syntax is constant, then leave a space, and then write the name of the constant that you are using. That is the constant name, like pi and so on. So next we have the integer values. So integer values, you know, it can be positive, negative, or zero, but the integer value never takes a decimal values. It cannot be like that we can we call an -7 integer as -7.0. So if you write it as -7.0, then it will not remain as an integer value. It will become a real value or a floating value. So it has been written that an integer must have at least one digit, and it does not contain any decimal point. So it is containing one digit and it cannot contain any decimal point. It may either have positive sign or negative sign. It can have the value ranging from negative to positive values. But the number with which the no sign is there, we have not included positive or negative sign, then it is automatically assumed that the integer value is positive. So we have these criteria in assigning the integer values, and commas never come in the integer. If you want to write 1000, then we don't write it as 1,30. It is written as 100. So commas are not inserted while writing the integer values. So we have here the declaration of the integer data type. So the integers are of three types in the programming language. It is integer, short integer, and long integer. So in the range of the integer and short integer is -32768 to 32768, means any number lying between these range of the number is admissible in the integer value range, either it be integer or short integer. But in the long integer, the list has been extended and the integer values take the values from -21474 83648 to positive value of 21474 83648. So you can see that the long integer list is quite lengthy than the short integer. And the memory storage that is allocated for the long integer is also twice the memory storage location allocated to the integer and short integer. So integer, short integer memory location is only storage capacity is 2 bytes, whereas for long integer it is storage capacity has been increased to 4 bytes. Also, the C++ language allows the three types of integer constants. So these are the three types of integer constants are having when the integers we'll have the decimal base 10. It is represented in the octal base 8 and the hexadecimal base 16. You must be knowing about all these numbers. So the next type of data type is the real valued or the floating point data type. As I have already mentioned, when you represent your integer value with a decimal sign and write any or either you are writing 00 also, then also the integer value is regarded as the real value. So the real value consists of the decimal values in addition to the integer values. So again, the declaration is done for the real values. So the real values are also declared in three types, that is the float, double, or the long double. So in the range of the float, it is from -3.4e to e means there is an exponential of 10 key power plus 38 to 10 key power. We have the number ranging from the negative value of 10 key power 38 to a positive value of 10 key power 38. For the double, the value starts from -1.7 into 10 raised to power 308. So the range where it was in the float 38 digit, now the digit has been increased to 308. And for the long double again, the double and the long double, the range is the same. Whereas the memory location allocated to the float is 4 bytes. For double, it is 8 bytes. As the name suggests, the double means the memory location is double. And for the long double, the 8 bytes has storage location is increased again by 2, that is the 10 bytes. So the real constants are the numbers having the fractional parts. Like we have here also written the range 1.78. So 78 means a fractional part of some value. So the real number is an integer plus a decimal value also. So it contains of fractional parts, and it is the real value is written in the representation of the real value consists of two types of the forms. One is the fractional form and the exponent form. So in the fractional form, it may have at least one digit before the decimal point. Like in this, we have written 3.4, 1.7. So always before a decimal point, it has a value, particular value, and at least one digit after the decimal point. So it is not necessary that it must have 2, 5, 6 or 10 or any number, but it is necessary that it has one digit. Either it can be 0 also. So if 7.0 we have written, it will be regarded as a real value and not as a integer value. So the fractional form consists of one digit before a decimal point and also a one digit after a decimal point. And it can have positive or negative value. Similarly, so in the fractional form, if we want to write the value, it is 1. So if we want to write, we can write the fractional form as 1.74. So the value could be taken as positive or it can be a negative value. But in the exponent form, this the way we have represented this value, the way we have represented this is the exponent form, where the exponent form consists of the our exponent form consists of two parts. One is the exponent, another is the mantissa. So exponent must be an integer. It is always an integer value. It never carries any decimal point. And the mantissa may be integer or proper real constant. So as you can see here, the range, the way we have expressed our range values is the formation of the exponent form, where the exponent is always having 38, 308. So it is always an integer value. It can take positive value or a negative value. But the exponent, that is the mantissa value, that is 3.4, 1.7, 1.78, it is always an integer. It could be a real value. It could be a floating value also. So the exponent is always integer value, and mantissa is always an integer or a proper real constant. And whenever we want to express our exponent and mantissa, then an alphabet E is always followed. The mantissa is always followed by the letter E and the exponent value of the exponent. So I hope that you have understood this real data type also. So next is our character data type. So what are the characters? Characters are any alphabets. It could be anything. So the range of the character is from minus 128 to 127. For the signed characters also, it have minus 128 to 127. But for the unsigned, it cannot take negative values. So it is from 0 to 255. So although the range is same from minus 128 to 127, also if we see count the units, the range, it is 255, but the number line has been shifted from the negative to the origin. So now the number line is not starting from negative 128, but for the unsigned character, it is starting from the origin, that is zero. So only 255 characters are assigned, and the memory location for the character is for character, signed character, unsigned character. For all the three, the memory location is 1 byte. So a character constant in C++ must contain only one character, and it is enclosed in single quotation marks. Like we assign X, A, B, C, D, anything. So it can be only enclosed in these single quotation marks. So next is the Boolean data type. As you know, you have studied the binary operations, AND gate, OR gate, or NOR gate. So always the output is always zero or a one value, it is on position or off position. That is why the range of the Boolean data type is always 2 digits, that is 1 or 0, and the memory location is always 1 byte. So it will always represent an on off condition or the true false condition. Next is the so these were the all data types. Next is the structural derived data types. So these are derived from the fundamental data types that we have already studied earlier. So these are the user defined data types. The user has defined these data types. So you know, what do you mean by derived? As you know that the length, mass and time are the fundamental units. So when we write velocity, velocity is length upon time. So because we are defining a new variable velocity, which is based upon the ratio of the length and time, so we say that the velocity is a derived unit. So similarly, we have the structure and derived data types, where the user has derived it from the fundamental data types. So its classifications is that we can arrange our data in array, we can arrange it in a function, we can arrange in the structure, we can classify it, we can point it. So these are the classifications we shall be studying in the next modules. So now is the escape sequences that is used in our programming. So whenever we want an output, certain characters are also spaced. So these are the commands which will invoke specific actions. So the first escape sequence is backslash n. So this is backslash n. So when suppose we have written these, you must be remembering our hello world. So if we have written hello world and we have inserted a slash n, then what will happen? That the hello world will be not typed in the first sentence, it would be typed in the second sentence or the new line. So if we want anything to be written in a new line, not in a single straight line, then we insert the escape sequence slash n. Similarly, we have slash r. So if we want that our file is printing 2 points of x and y, so it will not space between the x and y. One, it will give one value of x and one value of y. But we want that there is a one tab gap between the value of x and y. So when we print our output statement, so if we insert the escape sequence slash r, so it will create a tab gap that which will be the horizontal direction. So slash r will be the tab gap in the horizontal direction. Similarly, we have the slash v. So slash v will put it in your new vertical line. So the tab will be in the vertical direction and not in the horizontal direction. Similarly, if we want to insert the backslashes, so the escape sequence is double slash. And if we want to insert a question mark, so it is backslash question mark. If we want to put quote, it is backslash single quote. If you want to put double quote, it is backslash double quote. And if you want to put the zero, so it is backslash zero. So in this way, you can use this escape sequence, and the list is never ending. I have listed only a certain escape sequence. So you can see these escape sequences also. And we shall be learning new escape sequence while we are writing our program. So I hope that you must have understood about the escape sequence, the data types and the header files. And we shall learn more about it in our subsequent modules. Thank you.